of one God hearing from heaven and God moving him from nowhere into the middle of the action. God, unmovable. We don't know anything else about Ananias. We don't ever hear from him again after this account in the gospel. He's an unknown. But guess what? God used one man to deliver one message to one other individual, and that guy Saul ends up being the guy Paul, who writes most of the Bible that we read. If you are not of Jewish descent right now, you should give it up for Ananias. Regardless, in Isaiah, if you have a Bible, you can turn there with me. Isaiah chapter 43, I want to start with this Old Testament reminder of who Jesus is. This prophet is talking to people who have been discarded, they've been wandering for a while. He's reminding them of how good our God is, how in the middle of nowhere, God can stir something up. It's a vision of who Jesus is. He says this, forget the former things. Anybody glad that we serve a God that erases what has been? Write something new. Anybody grateful? Anybody standing up can preach with me today. Forget the former things and do not dwell on the past. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I'm making a way in the wilderness and I'm making streams in the wasteland. Think about that. I'm making a way in the wilderness. Streams in the wasteland. Can I read it again? Do not dwell on the things of the past. God is doing a new thing. Come on, somebody, stir yourself up. Woo! Call this message real simple. Let's keep it moving. Let's keep it moving. I think that's a word for from heaven for us. I like that phrase, let's keep it moving. I think there's something about being a Christian that we need to remind ourselves all the time. I've got some really good news for you, good news for myself, that God has a purpose in every single thing going on in your life right now. There is not one thing that will be wasted. He might not have caused it, but we serve a God that can keep things moving in such a way, even something that was meant to kill you, God can get some motion happening, some movement happening. Bring new life. Nothing is being wasted. We serve the God of the new thing.
Amen.
Keep it moving. Bro. How bad it's been, not interested. Keep it moving. There's a new thing. How good it might have been for you, keep it moving. There's even a better win for you. We need to be Christians that are ready for God to keep it moving in our lives.
Amen.
Please
Come
believe
on.
In this church. We're going to keep it moving.
Woo!
It's been awesome what God has done, but we are believing that the best is yet to come. But here's my thing, do not be a part of a growing church and have a shrinking life.
Ooh.
It's possible. Serve a God that is doing a new thing. Let's keep it moving. Maybe try some sort of hand signal right now. Make up your own and do it all week. Had three people played along. Great, great start, Lord. The opposite of keeping it moving, I think, is being stuck. You ever felt stuck in your life? Nobody ever? Just me, I have to go preach to myself and the four other people that have ever felt stuck. Where there's nothing moving. Maybe you've been stuck in a line. People saw something. Everybody's just looking at something to LA. It's trapped. And you're stuck and you can't figure out why you're stuck. until when a policeman shows up and he's always mad and he gets off his bike or whatever patrol car and he gets out. What does he do? Keep it moving, people. Keep it moving. That picture of traffic, you know what that is? That's religion. And that is life without Jesus. This is what people are caught up in. Traffic, going places, doing things. Everybody's stuck. Nobody knows how to get out. Doesn't matter how fancy your car is or if you're in public transportation, you're still stuck in the same grind. No one knows where to go. That's why Jesus showed up, and he's better than a policeman. He shows up in the middle of the traffic and he says, hey, anybody who wants out of this stuck traffic, come this way. Leave your life, leave your belongings, leave your worries. Stay in the one spot where Jesus got you moving. You went from death to life. You're a Christian.
Right.
Nothing worse than being stuck in traffic only to speed at the next red light. And you're stuck in traffic again. It's possible to be freed from something and get sucked right back into it. I believe that we are saved. God got some stuff moving. And we're supposed to continue to move with God, not pray. God, will you move? He's moving. Can we move with him? There has to be a new thing. There has to be a new revelation. There has to be a new breakthrough for us. We're Christian.
Woo!
I want to be somebody who is movable. Because I know God's going to move and I don't want to miss out on it. I know that God is at work. I don't want to be the guy who's stuck in traffic when all I had to do was, is your phone okay? Happy birthday, by the way. I don't want to be the guy who misses it because God was moving and I didn't know. I'm going to keep it moving. Some of y'all need to keep it moving. You've been stuck in some guilt. You've been stuck in some bad thoughts. You've been stuck in a dead-end relationship. This is your year to get it moving.
Woo!
You have the right to put your hand up and say, hey, Jesus, let's get it moving. Maybe your situation doesn't change, but your spirit, wow, new breakthrough, new opportunity. Can I read you a story about a man to me who represents what our church should be like at all times? Can I? I'm going to anyway. It's like a democracy all of a sudden. What do you want me to read? Pick a scripture. Acts chapter 9. You know what? This is a tough crowd. Let's go to Leviticus 8. Tattoos in the church, just the whole nine yards. People are like, finally! Can I give you some backstory? Remember, keep it moving. Keep it moving. I want to be somebody who doesn't have just one story to give. I want to give hundreds of stories. Not just one season of God doing stuff in my life, but dozens of seasons. Keep it moving. This story, they call Acts the Acts of the Apostles. It's actually a misquote by your, you know, fallible Bible commentary. It should be Acts of the Holy Spirit using regular men. They call it Acts of the Apostles. There's a moment here where a man named Saul, just give you a little bit of backstory so this makes more sense. Saul is the all-star of Judaism. He has murdered Christians throughout the region. He is known for his efficiency. He is the best of the best. Later, this guy gets saved and says, when I was a Jew, when I was doing that other thing, I was the best in the game. But God meets him directly where he is at. This guy is about his life, doing his thing, and he gets literally knocked over by the presence of God, and he gets blinded. We pick up the story. So I'm going to read to you about a man named Ananias, who to me is the unsung hero in this story. He's a man that was movable by God, and God moved him from obscurity directly into unbelievable influence. Is that a good setup? Worked so hard on it. In Damascus, there was a disciple named Ananias. Keep in mind, Saul, who will later be known as Paul, is laid up in bed. Doesn't know what's going on. It says, in Damascus, there was a disciple named Ananias, and the Lord called to him in a vision. He said, Ananias, yes, Lord, circle that. Yes, Lord. The Lord told him, go to the house of Judas on Straight Street. This is not the same Judas that betrayed Jesus, by the way. He's dead. He's long gone. It's a different Judas. It's an important detail. Yeah. And ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul, for he is praying. In a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias come and place his hands on him to restore his sight. Just freeze for a moment. Isn't it amazing that we have no idea what people are going through? We have no idea what people have been praying for. We have no idea what baggage and what pain and what misery people are walking through sometimes, and God is at work. Isn't that amazing?
Yeah.
Lord, Ananias said, I've heard many reports about this man and all the harm he has done to your holy people in Jerusalem. And he has come here with authority from the chief priest to arrest everybody who calls on your name. But the Lord said to Ananias, go! This man is my chosen instrument to proclaim my name to the Gentiles and their kings, to the people of Israel. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name. Then Ananias went to the house, and he entered, and placing both hands on Saul, he said, Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you were coming here, he has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit. Immediately something like scales fell from his eyes, and he could see again. He got up, he got baptized, and after getting some food, he regained his strength. Come on, somebody.
Woo!
This is an unbelievable moment of one God hearing from heaven and God moving him from nowhere into the middle of the action. God, unmovable. We don't know anything else about Ananias. We don't ever hear from him again after this account in the gospel. He's an unknown. But guess what? God used one man to deliver one message to one other individual, and that guy, Saul, ends up being the guy, Paul, who writes most of the Bible that we read. If you are not of Jewish descent right now, you should give it up for Ananias. Woo! God, and if I could put my hand up and say, God, I'm open to the new thing, whatever it is, and hear his voice, maybe you and I can play a part in the history of New York City never being the same. Somebody please shout me down.